is, as Kira said, more of a talk about kind of where we're at. I finished my PhD a few years ago, and I suppose similarly to H, trying to think, and what am I doing with any of this research, or what? Yeah, where to? My research is actually, because I'm from media, film and television, is more in terms of popular culture and politics. So I kind of have the last 10 years lost touch with the more community activist-based stuff that I used to do and really enjoy, and now it's all abstract and very academic and, so, but this is something that I have long been interested in, partly because of my lack of interest in rules and labels. That's probably the best way I can describe it. I'm sure my parents would describe it quite differently. But I'm not such a fan of the labels. And this is this question of the bathroom that has gained quite a lot more attention recently, that has, particularly in the United States, I mean, it's not new, obviously. I mean, we all know this, it's not new. But that it's recently gotten back into the public eye quite a lot more with the whichever side. So mostly what I want to talk about a little bit is that idea of kind of where we're at and the different aspects of where we're at in terms of popular culture and to activism online, offline activism, but also institutionally. And I should probably admit that I kind of, when I was preparing this, was very much a little bit intending to not be entirely complimentary about this institution. I'm going to try and be fair at any rate. So, yes. One of the interesting things is how it resonates with other discussions around rights and questions of segregation and access and discrimination that have cropped up in a whole range of other sort of political debates. Obviously, a lot of people refer back to Jim Crow era of segregation, water fountains for white, for black, and bathrooms for white, for black, you can't, and that kind of linking of certain biological discourse, as fallacious as it might be, with questions of power. And that obviously, though, there are enormous problems just in terms of that, making analogies between questions of racialized identities and gendered identities, not least because, as any genderqueer people of color will point out, that leaves them sort of nowhere. So those questions of intersectionality as well, but I do think that certainly in terms of making mainstream society more aware of this, that those can serve a purpose, those analogies, occasionally, as long as you're using them, you know, advisedly, but also, I suppose, the debates around gay marriage and what gay marriage will do to straight people or straight marriage or the gay agenda, as it was referred to. That idea that somehow or other, actually just basic human rights are turned around and then reconstructed discursively as an attack somehow on the dominant group. There was a wonderful, in response to the whichever sign, someone had written underneath, why does every bathroom have to be a social statement? This call for gender neutral bathroom. Why does every bathroom have to be a social statement? And the kind of idiocy inherent in that question of, well, of course it already is, every bathroom already is a social statement the minute you put your labels on it and insist with what I've decided to call genital essentialism, who can go where and who can't, and what kind of risks people are forced to face, questions of health and safety, but also questions of rights not to be discriminated against. That all of those, because for most people, it's not a question, they think that any attempt to change it is an attack somehow on them and what they believe in. That increasingly institutions have been more legally obliged, not necessarily very willingly, to start to accommodate this question of rights. Policies around health and safety, human rights, but that often these are a little bit fuzzy, and then there are also these questions of visibility, that even when institutions such as universities do even start to acknowledge that, they don't make it visible. It's very much, oh, okay, fine, you did it, now shut up. So there's quite a lot written about, from an academic perspective, about this kind of social geography, about segregation, and then moving towards acceptance, but how far we are in most instances from integration, and how much prejudice is still attached to that, and how insistent people are on clinging to these binary oppositions that insist on not only putting people into a daily position of having to make unrealistic choices, but also in positions of danger as well. So there is a lot of scholarship about it. There is also, like this, the Transgender Law Center in the US, the sort of activist attempts to try and raise awareness about this, and to start to try and, now we're, as these things go, in the cycle of fighting the backlash against that, that the original kind of political activism around trying to improve the facilities for everyone, but particularly to acknowledge trans people's rights as well, that there's been now a backlash against it, an attempt to sort of push back against those laws and policies, and now, again, the new wave of activism, like the whichever sign, coming through, trying to get an awareness around the fact that this is a question of rights. This isn't a question of trying to grant special privileges, which is also a discourse that you hear, why special privileges? Why do you get special privileges? That it's actually not. It's a question of human rights. That the policies, as I say, are not necessarily taken up by institutions, that there are very fuzzy policies, certainly in this country, which, yay, Hannah's going to be also looking at. That a lot of that is up to the institution to interpret how they wish. That there are a lot of loopholes and ways of figuring out how to get around it. So I was delighted to discover that the university has taken the time and effort to put a list on the website of gender-neutral bathrooms, but they've never publicized it at all. It's something that they have done and then just, we did it, okay, now. But it's, you know, in their defense, better than nothing, so yay. But again, still, even with that, if you are not proactively starting to try and change social perceptions or the general institutional culture around how people perceive gender variance, but also any measures that are taken to acknowledge human rights, that you kind of still end up with the same social problems, regardless of what the institution might have, on a purely policy level, have done. A lot of the backlash that you see around this question of trying to move away from the binary bathroom is that idea of threat. Not only the threat to, it's this straight, oblivious people, but that there is this idea that somehow or other, because of, and this is what Caitlin was talking about, a lot of that pathologizing through the medicalization of trans identity, that there is this sort of fear of trans people as somehow or other dangerous. That a lot of the ultra-conservative responses that you see to calls for bathroom equality are about how, but it's so dangerous. How will we, and there's always the discourse of that, how will we be safe? How will we know? And the response from activists is saying, well, do you think that that little sign on the door keeps you safe anyway? That somehow or other you're in the bathroom as designed by these social rules, that no one's going to come in who's a threat to you because there's a little sign on the door. Not so much. That there is quite a lot of research about how prevalent this is as kind of frontier of social and sort of the political barometer of how tolerant, at the very least, an institution is, society. And because obviously a lot of these are public places that are maintained by other people, the idea that comes out quite often is the idea of the airplane. When everyone's so upset about having these gender-neutral bathrooms, where on an airplane do you see the bathrooms segregated, and where do people get upset? No one minds. Everyone's fine with it. But somehow or other, this is still seen as it's a kind of bastion of heteronormative society, that you can't threaten this. And what that obviously ignores is how exceptionally dangerous and unsafe that is for the people who don't, can't, or won't fit into that binary. And that was obviously from a few years ago, but those statistics don't tend to change. How much harassment and physical danger that is enacted through this insistence on the binary. I will stop talking. That was the whichever, I'm sure you've seen the whichever sign that just kind of brought this debate back out again a few months ago. It isn't a debate that you see particularly visibly in this country, or I don't anyway, so if anyone does see it, I don't see this debate happening terribly much. It seems to be a debate that's happening more overseas, but obviously it's not a question that is not applicable here. It's equally applicable here. That was the one on the right. Wesleyan University in the States, that they, in an act of activism, ripped a small group of anonymous, supposedly, students, ripped all the signs off all the bathroom doors and replaced them with the gender-neutral restroom sign. And the university just went nuts. And they charged them, and they were all fined thousands of dollars for unspecified charges of damaging the university. And then the response of kind of support, but also the backlash, that there was a sign-making company who volunteered to come in and free of charge replace all of the signs. Part of that is a question, though, of discourse as well, of what do you replace it with? And this goes back to that question of labels and labeling things. And if we, you know, keep the bathrooms and we call them apple and orange, then, well, perhaps all the people who at the moment take those signs for granted will start to think, oh, wait, what am I? Am I an apple? Am I an orange? Maybe I'm not an apple today. Maybe tomorrow I'll be an apple, but today I won't be an orange. Those labels that might seem so natural to people who have been raised in that kind of heteronormative mentality, that they don't question it, that they think it is, oh, you're born this way, this is your sex, this is your gender, that's just how it is. Those kinds of signs reinforce that, and the more you can push back against that, then the better. But obviously from an institutional perspective, they still want to make sense, as it were. This is something that, like with all marginalized groups, is a question of both fear and fascination. If you look at popular culture, movies, for example, how often this question of the bathroom comes up. What happens? What happens when we get to the bathroom because of this insistence on some kind of genital truth, this genital essentialism, as it were? And this is something that I looked at in my thesis, the different kinds of movies, different genres, and how they kind of look at that question, whether it's a moment of comedy, like, oh, it's Mrs. Doubtfire, oh, wow, how hysterically funny, or horror in the kind of psycho mold of this, the monster. That this is something that does play out in the cultural imaginary, but it kind of reinforces these ideas of of what's acceptable and what's not acceptable, and who gets to make the labels and keep the labels, and how everyone else has to just live with them. So I don't think there's anything else I particularly want to say. It's just something that I'm interested in terms of how these waves of kind of activism and backlash and activism are happening, but also how little of it I see here. And those questions of the politics of visibility, of the dangers of being visible, but the dangers of being invisible and erased at the same time, and how you can try and make that work in a way that is about integration and not just tolerance. Okay, that's all. Thank you very much.